Hello, this is Pastor Jeff Short. Welcome to another edition of Christian Answers. And this week we're going to be talking about a friend of Evangelical Jan Hatmaker. And her friend is trying to defend her embracing of the LGBTQ agenda within the church. And so I'm going to take some time to just simply try to refute that defense of Jan Hatmaker. So let's jump right into the video.
Hey guys, so I wanted to talk about something that's sort of going around the internet right now, and that is the Christian response to certain Christians coming out, pun intended, as being affirming of the LGBT community. And by affirming, I mean suggesting that there be full inclusion and that gay and lesbian individuals do not need to change their orientation or do not need to be celebrated, but that their relationships can be fully celebrated within the church. We disagree on any number of things theologically. You can put 10 Christians in a room and we're going to disagree probably on 10 different things. There are Christians who think that salvation happens at the moment of baptism, and there are Christians that think that salvation happens when you say the sinner's prayer, and there's Christians who think, do you even need to be saved?
Well, here's an argument for radical relativism in the Christian church, because if you are a Christian and you consider a Christian someone who doesn't even or wonders whether or doubts whether it's important that you're even saved from eternal damnation or saved from your sins, saved from the wrath of God, the judgment of God. If you doubt that and you consider yourself a Christian, boy, she's really talking about a general broad term Christian here. And that would make sense because she's wondering why there's such a hue and cry over Jan Hatmaker's comments and her promotion of the LGBT cause. It's because true Christians are upset that someone would dismiss the Bible and 2,000 years of Christian history and act like it's no big deal. So her friend here seems to feel that Christians disagree on all kinds of things, so this is just one example of disagreement. What's the big deal? Well, the big deal is this is a moral value that is very important, because if this moral value falls and if the scripture is trampled upon when it talks about morality, then we may as well forget all about our message of redemption, because redemption presupposes sin. And if you've lost the ability to define what sin is biblically, then there is no clear understanding of salvation, because there's nothing to be saved from. If this is not a sin, then we don't know what a sin is. And if we don't know what a sin is, there's no need for a salvation message, and there's no need for a savior. So it all is connected together. And it's pretty bad when you have people here trying to water down Christianity in order to justify a certain current cultural practice, which is the LGBT behavior today.
There are Christians who think that when you take communion, that element turns into the body and blood of Christ in your mouth. And there's Christians who think that communion is just a nice symbol. There are Christians who think you need to go to confession, and there's Christians who think that that is not theologically sound. I mean, I could go on and on. There are post-millennial Christians and pre-millennial Christians. I mean, I went to Bible college. There are any number of issues that you could pull Christians on, and they don't agree, from how salvation happens all the way up to what happens when you die. Christians are not in agreement on the Bible. We cannot say the Bible is clear on XYZ when we all have this much disagreement.
Well, she's correct in saying that there are all kinds of things that Christians disagree with, again, but I have to repeat again, not all things that Christians disagree with are of equal importance. And this is an important issue. Why? Because, for one, the Bible is very clear on this. In fact, this is one of the areas where you have almost unanimity throughout all 2,000 years of Christian church history. You have traditional Eastern Orthodox Christians who say this is a sin, and you have Roman Catholic Christians who say this is a sin, and you have Protestant Christians that say this is a sin. You have the three major branches of Christianity that say homosexuality is a sin. The Bible clearly outlines it as a sin. So why would you want to contradict the Bible and Christianity in order to justify a contemporary social movement called the LGBT movement? We don't need to have the Christian faith uprooted, reinterpreted, and basically transformed in order to accommodate a contemporary movement. That's just a bad, silly policy, and we shouldn't buy into it.
I mean, the truth of the matter is, the Bible's not super clear on some things. So I find it interesting that with this wealth of disagreement that Christians have somehow been able to work through and be part of publishing houses, speaking teams, and call each other Christians, that it's this issue, the issue of including gay people, that everybody has to be theologically correct about.
Well, she's right. The Bible isn't clear about everything, but there are some things that the Bible is very clear about. And one of the things it's very clear about is the issue of homosexuality. The Old Testament condemns it. The New Testament condemns it. There is nothing in the Bible that would lead us to believe that God in any way accepts it. So it's a very clear issue. It shouldn't be a debate, and we should stop debating it.
And that we are going to disclude, we're not just going to disclude the LGBTs. We're going to disclude anybody who wants to include them. And that, to me, is horrifying. That this is where so many people feel the need to assert their theological stance. I mean, why not assert your theological stance on, you know, so many other things. So there are so many other things that we could argue about. And the fact that this has become a litmus test for how Christian someone is, for how much they care about or study the Bible, and for what people feel the need that they need to be vocal about.
But the point is that not all matters of disagreement are of the same degree of importance. And yes, you have diversity in the Christian church, but not on the core matters. And if you were to go back into church history and look at what defined morality in Christianity, you would find that there are some very core, central values that separate Christians from paganism. And one of the core values you would find is that Christianity defines morality within marriage. Sex before marriage, fornication, is a sin. It's always been a sin in Christianity, and it always will be a sin in Christianity because the Bible outlines it as a sin. Sex outside of marriage is adultery. That is a sin, and it will always be a sin in the Christian church because the Bible defines it as a sin in the Christian church. And the same way with homosexuality. Sex with two women or sex between two men, homosexuality or lesbianism, is a sin. And it is defined that way in the Old Testament. It's defined that way in the New Testament. And there's no getting around it. If you try to do away with this definition that is found in the Bible, you have to do away with all of Christian doctrine and morality, because you are taking apart the entire moral foundation of Christianity to define sin. And if we can't define sin, then we have no need for a savior. So this is a big deal. She's relativizing truth. I don't know if she understands it or not, but if you do that, you are undermining your own Christian faith.
And, you know, here's the thing, too. I'm seeing so many people being called brave because they have decided to write these statement pieces about what Jen said. That's not brave. That is not brave. I mean, if you woke up 2 weeks ago and decided, I'm going to share my theological opinion on homosexuality, that might be brave. But when you write an opinion piece that's based on throwing Jen Hatmaker under the bus because she's popular and says something you don't agree with, that's not brave. You're not saying that out of some grand moral conviction that you woke up with. That's, you're just trying to prove somebody wrong on something that makes you super uncomfortable.
Well, that's not true. It is. It does take some courage, and it does mean that you are brave to be able to speak out on these issues in today's culture. Now, if you try to speak out on these issues in public in today's secular world, you have to be brave. And so anyone who would write an article in the newspaper or would say anything on the internet or post anything on the internet does have to have some courage today. It actually takes more courage to be a biblical Christian today than it ever has been because of the way our morality and spirituality has so declined in the Western world, especially here in the United States. And so it does take courage. And I don't think this friend of Jen Hatmaker should belittle the fact that it even takes courage today to speak out on these issues in the church, because there is so much peer pressure to not say anything or to not disturb anything or political correctness, that even in a church context, it takes quite a bit of courage to even address these issues. I think traditionally Christians have not talked about these issues because of inappropriateness, politeness, and just these are things that are usually to be kept in private conversation. But we're going to have to be talking about them today in public because now Christian morality is under attack, and it's even being attacked within the church by people who call themselves Christian leaders like Jen Hatmaker, and even by people in the denominations and even pastors and high-profile Christians. So we need to speak out on these issues. We need to rebuke, exhort, and contend for the faith, which the Bible says to do.
And clearly Christians are super uncomfortable about gay people, because if we weren't, this would not be the theological fight we're all having with each other.
I don't think it's because Christians are uncomfortable with gay people. I think Christians feel intimidated by the LGBT movement coming into the church and trying to change Christian teachings on core moral values. So we're being put on the defensive because out in society in general, this LGBT movement is taking over government, taking over the educational system, taking over business world now. You have all these corporations lining up with the LGBT agenda and promoting same-sex marriage and transgenderism and everything under the sun. And you have society in general now flip-flopping. Just 50 years ago, society in general would have been solidly Christian on this issue, but now it's flip-flop, and you have more people, the majority of people, more citizens of our country, even here, United States, now the statistics show in favor of gay marriage, LGBT causes, and that puts the Christian church under fire. And if that's not enough, we have to contend now with these people who are supposedly Christians bringing the LGBT movement into the church, and we have to defend Christianity within the walls of the church. We have to defend the Bible. We have to defend Christian doctrine and morality. And yeah, so hey, no wonder Christians are speaking out and writing articles and trying to do everything they can to defend Christianity, because it is literally under attack. And Jen Hatmaker has become, unfortunately, an enemy of Christian morality, and so has her friend here trying to justify and defend her in her false teachings.
So that's one thing that's bugging me, is that we're making this the theological fight when we have plenty of other theological disagreements. The second thing that's really bugging me is this notion that anybody who doesn't take the Bible as completely literal on the issue of homosexuality doesn't hold a high view of Scripture and is picking and choosing on what they take as literal versus cultural or contextual edict in the Bible.
Well, I have to go over some basic things here. Now, this woman, the friend of Jen Hetmaker's, says that she's gone to Bible college. Well, if she had read the Bible and learned how to study it, you would realize that it's too simplistic to say take the Bible literally or don't take the Bible literally. You take the Bible as to what it's supposed to be teaching. If it's a poetic session, you take the Bible poetically. If it's historical narrative, you take it historical narrative. If it's a story, a parable, you take it as a story or a parable. You interpret the Bible as the author intended it to be taken. And when you find the teachings against homosexuality in the Bible, they're straightforward commands. They're admonitions. They're warnings. They're straightforward teachings. So it's not a question of, do we take that teaching literally or not? It's, what does the author intend it to be taken? And if you go, for example, there are many different passages in the Bible, but if you go into the book of Romans, the first chapter, where the Apostle Paul talks about a great list of different sins, it talks about God's wrath, and it talks about different forms of sins. And it says here, for example, in Romans 1:26, it says, because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned the natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. So they're very strong teachings right there against lesbianism and gay male sexuality. So it's not a matter of taking it literally or non-literally. It's just taking it seriously, taking what the Bible teaches about its own teachings and applying it the way the Bible wants us to apply it. And it's not a real difficult problem with this teaching. It is so crystal clear. So to say that it's a literal, non-literal issue, no, it isn't. It's just simply taking the Bible at face value.
Here's the deal, you guys. We all pick and choose about what we take as prescriptive from the Bible, and specifically from the Old Testament, which is where most of these verses are coming from. We're all picking and choosing. I don't know, I don't know a single person who takes every edict in the Bible as a prescriptive. The only person, honestly, that I know who has done that is Rachel Held Evans, and she did it to write a book to prove the point that we're all picking and choosing. So, you know, unless you are going to go out this weekend and protest Red Lobster for serving shellfish, or you are going to go out and sleep in a tent this weekend when you get your period, or you're going to stone somebody because they are out of line, or you're covering your head as a woman, like, you're not taking every single scripture as literal either. None of us are. A lot of the stuff in the Old Testament is culturally contextual. You know that, and I know that, which is why you're not following all of it. You're not probably taking the entire Sabbath and following it like, anyway. Again, I could go on and on this, but
this is a false argument. For one thing, the New Testament guides us as to what we are to apply from the Old Testament. For example, we learn in the New Testament that we are not obligated to keep the Sunday Sabbath. It's clearly taught in the New Testament. We're also taught that all food is clean in the New Testament. We are taught the guidelines as to what applies and what doesn't apply. So this argument that we just pick and choose. No, we don't pick and choose. We apply what should be applied in the New Covenant era, and we don't apply what shouldn't be applied in the New Covenant era. And it's not a relativistic soup like we're hearing from this apologist for Jen Hatmaker. And it doesn't allow you to take all the Christian morality and throw it in the pot and say, well, we all pick and choose anyway. No, we don't. And that's a false argument.
I think it's insulting. It's insulting to your fellow Christian brothers and sisters to say to someone who's come to a different interpretation of Scripture that they just don't get it or that they don't care about the Bible. It's insulting, and it's hypocritical.
It's not insulting and it's not hypocritical for a Bible-believing Christian to rebuke another fellow Christian for false teaching. And that's all we're saying we're doing. And we will continue to do that until they understand that they are out of line. It's not hypocritical. It's being Christian.
And I mean, again, this isn't a conversation about Jen, but to use her as an example, I don't know someone who cares more about Scripture. I don't. That girl loves Jesus with her whole heart and cares deeply about the Bible.
Well, the issue is not whether she cares deeply about the Bible or not. The issue is whether she is handling God's word correctly. And what we're saying is she is handling God's word incorrectly. She is drifting into false teaching. We're rebuking her and correcting her so that she doesn't spread her false teachings to the wider body of Christ. That's it.
And to see her being thrown under the bus is so hurtful. And it's hurtful to me, but let's talk about who it's really hurtful to. The whole LGBT community. I mean, you guys, Christians, let's circle up here. This is embarrassing. This is so embarrassing that a popular Christian came out and said, I'm cool with people being gay, and it caused this much of a backlash. It's embarrassing. And people are watching.
Isn't it more hurtful to the LGBT community when Christians let them go on in their sins, do not call them to repentance, and let their souls perish for all eternity and face a judgment without God? Isn't that embarrassing? Isn't that careless and soulless to allow someone in error to continue in their error and not try to save them? That's what's really the crisis here.
And people get, I mean, nobody's stupid. They get that this is the argument that we're having over theology and not anything else. They get it. So anyway, I don't know. I just felt the need to rant about that today because I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed in the Christian community right now. I'm embarrassed. I'm disappointed that this is becoming such an issue. And I'm sad that the church is having this kind of litmus test over whether or not you're a real Christian.
Well, you should be embarrassed, but you should be embarrassed for your friend, Jen Hatmaker, that is teaching false and damnable false doctrines and really corrupting morality in young people. You should be embarrassed that there are Christians who are espousing the LGBT philosophy. And you should be on the side of truth, and you should worry about theology, because theology matters. Correct doctrine matters. Correct morality matters. Truth matters. And you should be more concerned about the truth of God than you are about what the LGBT community thinks of Christians in this time of crisis. You should be more concerned about what God thinks than what the LGBT community thinks.
Guess what? A bunch of us, myself included, are real Christians. And we are reading scripture, not reading our feelings, but reading scripture, and coming to the conclusion that we're okay. We're okay with people being gay. And not okay like love the sinner, like we're okay with like go ahead and get married in our church and come and serve in children's ministry in our church. And
I don't doubt that you're a real Christian. I don't doubt that you love the Bible. I'm simply saying, and so are other Christians saying, you're wrong. You are very wrong. You are gravely wrong. You are doing much damage in the body of Christ, and you're ultimately hurting LGBT people because they won't hear the message of repentance. You are working against the truth, and we are calling you out on it, and we are saying you need to repent of it.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, we need to love better. We do. We need to love better. We need to, you know, I get that there are a lot of people out there who feel that scripture compels them to hold a view that homosexuality is a sin. I get it. And I have been that person. I get it. But that feeling and that scriptural interpretation that you hold, that should not be your sole public platform. Probably shouldn't be your public platform at all.
It wouldn't be a public platform, and we wouldn't have to speak out and speak so forcefully if you would simply stop promoting the LGBT cause contrary to God's will in Scripture, and stop bringing that cause into the church, and stop spreading the lies and untruths of that movement. That's all. So if you stop being publicly LGBT, we will stop rebuking you. And it's that simple.
And if that's what you're shouting from the rooftops over any other number of scriptural interpretations you hold, I think you need to have a come to Jesus meeting with yourself. Anyway. Yeah. That's all I have to say. I would love to hear your comments and thoughts on this.
And I would just challenge you to get alone with the Bible and get on your knees and look at these passages and be honest and say, what does God's word teach here? And read it for what it says, and don't color it with the lens of the LGBT cultural conditioning that we're all under right now. Look at what God's word is saying and just believe what God's word is saying. Well, I hope that brings a little clarity as to why this is such a big deal. Jen Hatmaker is a popular Christian speaker. She's gone off into apostasy and heresy. We need to bring her back, and we need to rebuke her in love. In Jesus' name, amen.